Hi guys, I've done a few different page turn rigs and book rigs over the years, and after seeing Mark Warner's tutorial last week, I was kind of inspired to revisit it. So this is the one I'm going to show you guys. It's not the most physically accurate out of all the ones that I've done, but if I didn't know how to do any, this would be the one that I would want to know how to do. So I'm just going to run through this briefly and show you. I'm recording this afterwards, so I'm just going to run through this and show you the different features of this rig real quick. And I'm going to just narrate it as we go, and then we'll start on the tutorial. I kind of like doing this because it gives you an idea of what we're doing before we start doing it. So basically, all we have is in Modeler, it's just a page cloned right on top of one another. And that's it. That's all there is for Modeler. And there's bones in the background. And they're in another layer, though. That's important for this. So then I have one node network that just does a whole bunch of different things, actually. And I use these sliders to control all the different features of this book rig. And it really is totally non-destructive, this rig. So the control I'm doing now is the page turn. And that controls the turning of the page. And then this next control that I'm using is the spread, how many pages are controlled by the turn. And this is being played back at 200%, so consider that. And now I'm just showing you that it's subpatch object here. So if you start to get a lot of pages, you can adjust your resolution accordingly so you're not using a real heavy mesh. The displacement order has to be on last, though, because you don't want to be calculating all those subdivisions in your displacements. So here's the random feature. It randomizes the pages. If you go too high, you're going to get intersection, but I still let you go above what you should, just in case for certain sections of the book you might want to have it extreme. So that's pretty much all the features. I skipped on the binding. You didn't hear me do that. There is a binding feature which closes up the binding to make it more like a magazine. That was it, the first one. So now this, what I'm showing you here is the UV features, and that's the red controls. So that's the UV space in between them. And this is just so you can lay out for your UVs, or if you just want to lay your pages out as a spread, it gives you that option. So if you want to do renders like that, you can. But I did it for UV purposes mainly. Now this next section is the UV scale, and that will allow you to create a UV map. Because you got to consider, when you use subpatches, you lose your ability to use parts in your surfacing. So I wanted a way to get control over each page individually, like an index per page. So we could do that by just scaling them down and creating a UV map, just with them spaced out evenly along the U. Then we can get an index for each of our pages surfacing. So that's why I did it that way. So now the next thing I'm going to show you here is how bones are used. And this is the best part of this setup, in my opinion. Using bones like this has a lot of implications for stuff other than this. For any type of animation where you want to have animation of objects trailing bones, you could use something similar to this setup. You could do a lot of cool motion graphics stuff with this setup as well. So what I have here is, now you'll see if I scrub through the timeline, that bone, that's what we get for the bone animation. But that's still totally live, meaning I'm going to go to halfway through the animation, grab some of them bones, and we're going to do a little bit of a twist on them. Now, that's not 100% physically accurate, because there is some deformation going on, but you could definitely get away with doing it, and you'll never know. Nobody will ever know that you're really deforming the page unnaturally. It'll never be noticed. So there's a lot that you can do with this rig. It's really versatile. So now the great thing is now that change on those bones will update automatically, meaning now when I turn the pages, it's going to follow that pattern. So it's really, really Now, I think I do show you the node network quickly, just to show you what we're dealing with. And that's pretty much all there is to it. There's bottom ones there. That's for the UV map. So that's all the controls for the actual animation, is that section I'm showing you right now. That's the bones. Those three bone infos in the middle. You definitely have never seen bones used like this before. I can promise you that. So now I think I show you the surfacing real quick. So that's what you get. I have two images. That's the surfacing. I don't go over this in the tutorial, but I use both UV maps, and they're in the file as an example, and this is the images. So it's just two images, and then based on the side, the polygon side, we choose which image to use. So that's how it's done. Okay, so let's get started on the tutorial. Okay, I slowed it down to 150%. That should be good enough for me to explain this. If you start to not be able to follow, or if it starts to not match up perfectly, just slow it down and go along with the file in the description. But I think we'll be perfectly fine like this. So I'm just creating a box here, and it's 14 by 14 here, 14 meters by 14 meters, and I have it segmented like this. Now, what I'm doing is, now I'm just messing with the surfacing, which isn't important. So I'm just going to knife this in a couple spots along the edges. And the reason I'm doing this is because this is going to be a subpatch object. And what I'm going to do here is drag all those points so that all the edges are right on top of one another. And that'll make sure that no matter what, we always have an extremely crisp page. So now you'll see once I move all these out. Now I also quantize these points just to make sure they're all on a meter mark. And just to let you know, scale isn't really important here because we can scale this down to whatever size we want once we get our object how we want it in layout. It can be scaled automatically. So now I put it in subpatch mode, you'll see. So that's what we get. I'm using regular subpatches here, not Catmull Clark, because the UVs are important, so we want to be able to get good subpatch UVs. So there's the object, and I think I put one in the last layer I do, because I want to save it there. And now I'm cloning the first one, and I've made 50, so there's 51 pages all sitting right on top of one another. And right now I'm just creating a point. And this is for the polys, or for the bones. I'm just creating a two-point poly chain. I'm extruding this point to create a two-point poly chain. And then I'm going to convert that to skeletons. And it's also, the positioning of this is kind of important. I want it to start 1 meter before our pages, and I want it to end two longer than them. But I want the segments to be equally spaced. So you'll see what I'm getting at it in a second here. So you'll see that now I converted that two-point poly to skeletons. Now I'm just deleting the two-point poly, rotating the skeletons because they were in the opposite direction, and just placing them right where I need them. So now I have just a row of skeletons that go straight down. They correspond to a meter mark. And that's kind of important. You'll see I'm using the object spot again to move things to bones by index. So it helps that our object lines up on the meter mark. There's other ways we could have gone about it. So now I'm just sending everything to layout. So I have our 50 pages and our Skelligons. 51 pages and our Skelligons here. So now I just turn the subpatch level down and put it on last. Just changing the color. And now I'm going to convert them to Skelligons to bones. So there's all our objects from Modeler. Now the first thing we're going to do here is we need to spread those pages out in either direction, because they're all on the origin right here. So the way we're going to do that is we're going to use the part index. So I'm just going to get part move. We're just using the index here. We're kind of using the index and the total here. And we're going to use the index to move them along in a certain direction. And the reason I'm using move instead of the actual part move to move them is because we have a little bit more deformation to do for the binding. And this makes it easier doing it like this. You'll see why as we go further. So now all we're doing is making a setup so that half the pages will go on one side and half the pages will always scale to the other side. So I'm subtracting one from the total just because the index starts at zero. So it just makes the calculation work. Then I'm multiplying the total by 0.5. Now I'm subtracting the total from the index, so it's always going to push half on the other side is what's happening there. So now when I multiply that by an amount, it's always going to be pushing half of them into the negative, and that's what's happening there. I'm just subtracting half so that it always goes to the other side of the so we don't have the book goes on either side of the bones basically, and you'll see here. So now if I multiply that index, that's multiply that index, and this is where our first control comes into play. So I'm just going into the move and then into the scale, but we're only dealing with the move now. So what I'm doing here is I'm just getting a constant scalar, and this scalar is what's going to determine the width of the book, or the page width basically. So that's what I'm naming it right here, page width, and that's going to turn into our first slider. And I'm just making an envelope so that it shows up in our envelope list. So now it's on 1, so you'll notice that when I go in there, it goes real big, so I just change it to 0. So now we're just scaling that amount, that index, by an amount, and that's moving them along on the x-axis, and that's all that's going on there. And I'm just creating a slider here, and I'm just grabbing that channel. This page width scalar, and I'm making it between 0, and I actually changed this in the file, but for now I'm just making it go from 0 to 0.1, I think I make it. But I go into the negatives because I thought it would be better to have the option to go in the other direction if you want to turn your book from, well, it just gives you another option. So now we have a slider that controls our page width here. So now you'll see, if I scrub through that, you'll see we get that animation there. And I had moved the object a little bit. I noticed that I do that a couple times throughout here. I always make sure I fix it though. I might not catch it while I'm doing it, but I do fix it on the file in the description. If it's off a little bit, I make sure everything's where they're supposed to be. So now the next thing we want to do is we want to have a control for the binding to suck them points, them first set of points that are closest to the z-axis in toward the origin. And you'll see how I go about doing that. Basically all we do is we scale that vector that goes into the move. So now I can control the scale of that vector with another control. So I can move them however I want, but then I can control the scale of that, and I just use the distance on the Z here, because I know my first points are at 1 meter, so I could just say anything after 1 meter, do this to it, or anything before 1 meter, do this to it. So basically what's happening is anything past 1 meter on the Z, it's just going to keep the scale from the vector that's going into it. And then what I do is that for the second key in the gradient, which would represent zero, for the first key in the gradient, which represents zero on the Z, I control that with another control. And you'll see I go into the first key's color. So now anything below one, I will have control with this slider, and that's what's happening here. So now I can control the scale of that on just below 1 millimeter or 1 meter. So you'll see that gives me that effect. Keep in mind this will be sub-patched when it's all said and done. So it'll be a little more smoother of a curve than this. Plus I wanted to keep this as low res while I'm working on it as I could. So now I'm just adding that control, which is binding. I'm going to add that to our sliders, and I make that from 0.01 to 1. And that gives me that control. So now I have control over the width and the binding. And I kept everything one-sided because I wanted to have some concept of our orientation while we were working on this, because it's good to know that you're working on it in the proper orientation as you're expecting. So that's why I left it one-sided for now, so I always know what that other side is. So now I'm just testing out the controls that we got. So now the next thing we got to deal with is we're going to deal with the aspect and the scale. The next thing is the scale. And they're all using 0, 0, 0 as the center for their scale, and that's fine for what we're doing here. Because you'll notice I didn't define a center for the scale, and it doesn't matter because 0, 0, 0 will work fine for the transforms that we have to do. So now I'm getting another control, and this one I'm going to call aspect. And this is going to control the Y scale, basically, of our pages. So I'm going to just take that, and I'm going to go into the Y of this make vector, and go into the scale. And now I have to fix it, this X and the Z. The Z actually is going to be set to 0, but for now I'll put it at 1 so you can see what's going on. We need to set the Z scale to 0 because we got to bring our bones into this, and that's, we need the Z scale to be at 0 before we use our bones. So, but for now, just to see the aspect part of this. So I did the aspect from 0 to 2, so I can, or 0.1 to 2, I think I did. So now you'll see we'll be able to scale that on the Y. Just testing all the controls again. So now, like I said, the next thing we have to deal with is we're going to scale all them back to 0 on the Z. And that's important because we need to get these bones into the mix here. So now all that is scaled back to 0 on the Z. And now we can start moving these to the bones and allow the bones to take over the position and rotation of our mesh. And so the way we're going to do that is, well, the first thing we're going to need to add, because we're going to have to add that to the current position that the points are at. And I'm getting a bone info here, DP kit bone info, and I'm selecting the object that the bones are, the second layer. And now you can see we have time and item on that bone, and that should be ringing some bells for some of you guys, because that's really actually pretty powerful, being able to use it like this. So now what's happening is if we remember, our object goes from 0 to 14 meters, and our bones here go from, they're in reverse, actually. You'll notice I scroll through them, it goes from 1 to 17, but in the opposite direction. So we're going to have to remap our object spot of our page in order to get the indexes to match up with the bones. So I'm going from 0 to 14. That's our object position. And then I'm remapping it from, you'll see, from 16 till 2. And if you watch me scroll through that, you'll see where I stop and start. And that remaps our object spot so that it lines up with the index of the bone. That's all that that's doing. So now that we have the index, or each of our object spot is matched up with an index, if we just take that world position from that bone, you'll see it moves our object spot right to that world position of that bone. And now you can see how this becomes powerful. And because now we have control of the time too. And that's pretty much what makes this all work. But we have to deal with rotation because we need it to orient in toward the bone. And we have to deal with that because it's not going to do it automatically for us. So what we're going to have to do is we're going to have to get the bone. Now, the one thing to try here is just to get a rotation matrix to HBB and just use the up, right, and forward of that bone that you're on and see what that gives you. And now you'll understand why I'm doing it this way, because we need the tangent, not the actual direction. So what I'm doing is I'm getting the bone before and after the one we're on. And that's also why I left the extra ones in our setup. It's because it makes this setup a little bit easier, because we don't have to account for being at the edge. So now I have the bone before and after. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to subtract the bone before and after the world position. And I'm rotating it here. I rotated two of the bones so you could see why we need to do this and if it's working or not. So what I'm doing here is I'm just going to subtract the world position of the previous bone and the world position of the bone after it. And I'm going to cross that with the right vector of the actual bone we're on. And that's going to allow us rotation in all axes, Well, it should have, but I messed up here. It doesn't show itself because that second add should be across, and I catch it eventually, but I don't yet. But you'll look now. Our rotation works as you would hope it would, and that's what that does. And like I said, that add should be across. I catch it a little bit later. It doesn't show here because we're only rotating on one axis, but it would have popped up sooner if I would have rotated on another axis. But so now we have the bone controlling the position and rotation, and we also have control of the time. So that's pretty much what makes all this work. So now what I'm doing here is I'm just making a bone animation. I'm doing the animation for the bone, and I'm doing it over 1 second just because it'll make the setup a little easier, because I can go from 0 to 1. Just makes things a little bit simpler to deal with. When I'm offsetting the animation, I know that the animation goes from 0 to 1, so it just makes all the calculations easier. So now, like I said, I'm just doing a little bit of an animation on here. And you have to be careful with the easing, with the keyframe interpolation on the first on the first bones, on the first couple keyframes, because you don't want them to go into the negative. It'll start to cause overlap. So you have to just keep an eye on that. For the first couple bones in the chain, you got to watch that you don't get any crazy interpolation going on. It could mess up your animation. So I'm just doing a quick and dirty animation here. It's nothing spectacular. I really didn't spend any time doing it. Like, if somebody really wanted to spend time doing this setup a lot, like, make everything real nice, they could do something really good with this setup. I think I set this up in under an hour. So now I'm just fixing the pages. Now that I know that everything's oriented the way I need it. I was just waiting until after I dealt with the getting things stuck to the bones before I put it on double-sided. That way I knew my orientations were all right and nothing was flipped. That's why I did that. So now I think I go into the graph editor and change this to TCB. And I don't know if I catch it here, but it does cause an issue. I don't notice it. I might be able to show you on the graph if I zoom in. It's not real noticeable, but I do go back and fix it at some point. Okay, so now there's our page turn. So now the next thing we deal with here is getting the actual offset of the, so we can turn the pages individually. And the way we do that is we're going to use two controls, two sliders, but what we're going to do is we're going to use a gradient. And the input for that gradient is going to be the part index. And we're basically going to be pushing keys through a gradient that are the gradients based on the part index. And then those keys will have a value, and that value will determine the time of our bones. So you'll see how we set this up. I'm just creating a gradient. So I can make it from 0 to 1, the color, because 1 is our full animation. Because remember, I made it from 1 second. Our time is 1 second is our full animation for the page. So that's why I'm able to just go from 0 to 1. So now I'm getting the index of our part. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to get two constant scalars, and these are going to be represent the turn and the spread control. So basically the turn is just going to be the position of one key, and then the spread is going to be the turn plus the spread, or the next key, I should say, is going to be the turn plus the spread. So it's going to always give you in between, an amount in between those two. So I'm just going to say that the key two is the turn plus the spread. And then if I go from the color into the time, now these have to be set on absolute. That's also important. You'll notice when we set these to absolute, the animation no longer plays, I show you. And that's because whatever gets plugged into that time is what gets played. And there's nothing going into it now. It's just set to 0. So now, whatever I plug into that will play back that animation based on what's plugged into it. And we're playing it back based on the part index. So you'll see I'll add those two controls, the turn and the spread. And I put it into the negatives because you have a spread, you might need to go into the negatives with the turn. But I made the max 100 pages. So it goes from negative 20 to 100. If you wanted to go more pages than that, then you could just change it. But I won't ever go above 100, probably, I doubt. I mean, maybe, but not for a magazine, usually. So now I have two more controls, the turn and the spread. And you'll see the spread does that. So now I'm just lengthening the distance in those keys in the gradient, basically. And now when I move the turn, it's actually pushing all those keys through the gradient. So the spread is the distance between the keys, and the turn is... I kind of did another tutorial that used this concept, similar concept. It was called Radial Array. And it used a similar concept to that with the keys and the gradient. But it's a good way of going about it. So that's the control for the turn and the spread. Now, there's one more control we add that has to deal with the animation for the book. And that is the randomness, and that's not real hard to do either. So all we got to do to deal with the randomness is I'll just wait till we go into the nodes. So all we're going to do is see how we have that index going into the input. So what we're going to say is we're going to get a random number based on that index between, well, I'm going to do negative 1 and 1, but anything more than 0.5, you'll get overlap. The higher, you're more likely, the higher over you go, you'll get more overlap. So now what I'm going to do is I'm just going to multiply that number, that random number, by a constant scalar. And that scalar is what will expose. So what I'm doing is I'm adding that index to a random number between 0 and 1, and I'm moving it that direction. And then the scalar that I'm making here, that's called random, will just be a multiplier of that random number. So it'll scale it from having no random number to full random number. That's all that scale's doing. The scalar that I name random is just scaling that random number before it gets added to the actual index. So you have control of how random of the number, or how much of the random number gets added to the index. So you can have none of the randomness or all of the random. So now you'll see I'm just testing the random. Just made an envelope for it so that we can access it. Added it to the sliders. And then I think I test it, yeah. Just testing out everything, making sure everything works as expected. So you'll see once I go above 5, you start to go overlapping pages, and you don't want that. So halfway is about as much as you want to go for the whole, if you're going to use it for the whole book. Because any more than that, you're going to get overlap. But you can see how the pages are randomized. Some are close, some are far. It's a pretty good effect, actually. So pretty much that's all there is to setting it up. The next part we deal with is dealing with the UV layout. So I'm just saving everything. Saving the scene, saving the objects. And I might rearrange a few of these sliders. I think I do. I think I put something up top, aspect up top. I think that's pretty much all I do with that, though. And then the next thing we deal with is pretty much just dealing with the... dealing with the UV part, but dealing with the UV layout. And to do that, pretty much all we do is use the index of the part to create a 2D array. That's pretty much all we're doing. And then we use a couple constant scalars as inputs for that, so we can adjust the spacing and the rows and that kind of stuff. So it's just pretty much... So now I just unhooked everything. So I'll use a switch to go between that version and the UV version. So I'll do that after I set up the UV version. So now I just get a bunch of math nodes, typical nodes you need to create a 2D array. Divide mod floor. So I'm just dividing and modding the index right there. And I'm gonna get all the nodes I need together. I'm getting the part move, because I'm gonna use part move for this, because that's, I don't need any kind of per point deformation here. Just the whole part's fine. And I need the aspect. Remember that aspect control that we have? Because that's going to determine, we're going to need that for our spacing. And this part might get a little complex for as quick as I have to narrate it, but if it starts to, just go through the file and put it on slow motion and just follow right through with it, and it starts to become more obvious. So I'm just creating a vector there. That's going to be the position that we're going to move to eventually. And creating a scalar, and this one's called size. That's the total size here. It's not going to change. We're not going to use the size because it's just a 14 by 14 square. So that's not one that gets exposed. But spacing, which is one I just created, that does get exposed. And the aspect is already exposed in our sliders. And then there's a few more. Then this is rows and columns, because I need control over the rows and columns. That does get exposed. And there is one more, but that's all I think I do for now. So I'm just flooring the rows, so it's only ever going to input whole numbers in here. So now I'm just going to... Now I can go through and create what I'm dividing and modding by it, with one control, basically. It's all that's doing. That's what the rows is doing. I'm creating what I'm modding and dividing by, and then I'm flooring the divide when it comes out, so that it's only giving us whole numbers again. But I wanted to floor it when I went into the mod as well, because I don't want that returning anything but whole numbers. So now what I'm doing is I'm adding the size to the spacing. And then I'm going to multiply that by our mod. And that's going to determine our Z position. So you'll see now, by multiplying the size by the spacing, the size is just going to be constant, but the spacing we can change. That's going to be exposed. So that causes me to be able to change that gap in between our pages. So now what I'm doing here is I'm multiplying the aspect by the size, and then I'm adding that to the spacing. So now I'm getting the aspect multiplied by the size and going into the spacing. So now that our aspect, this will adjust for our aspect, basically, is what that will cause to happen. So whatever aspect we have our pages at, now you'll notice that the spacing is a little bit off here. You notice that the center, the ones between the vertical, is a little bigger. And that's because if you look, my aspect isn't at 1 right now. It's a little bit above 1. Because what we also need to do is now that we've brought the aspect into affecting the array, we also need to bring the aspect into affect the actual scale of our parts. Because we want the aspect to be the same as it was in our regular book. Because if we're making UVs, we want the UVs to have the same aspect. So that's what all this is for. It's just to ensure that we're always getting the right aspect when we make our UV, when we go to our UVs. So I'm just getting, this is going to go into the scale now. So you'll notice I'll take the aspect and go into the scale. And we get exactly what we need. So I can change the aspect and it'll always update in the UVs. So I think the next thing I deal with here is the scale. Remember that scale feature that allows us to scale the UVs down to single points? And that's what I'm doing here. I'm just creating another scaler. This one's going to be called UV scale. This will be a slider at some point. And what I'm going to do is I'm just going to do similar to what we did with the move. I'm going to scale that vector. Remember I just used that scale, the went into that scale with the aspect. So now I'm just going to scale that vector. So it's just going to be able to give me what's going into it or zero, basically, depending on what I do with the vector scale. And you'll see there's our single points. So that just scaling that vector is allowing us to push everything down to zero scale. So now what I'm doing here is there's one more thing that we have to deal with, and that is I'm just exposing the envelopes for the ones I need, and I also need one more, and that's going to control the switch in between both of our deformations, the UV deformations and the deformations for the animation part. And we're just going to use a mixer to do this. And that UV layout that I just created, that scale will just control the switch. It's like a switch, basically. So I'm just going to get a mixer. And then I'm going to use that scaler, the UV layout scaler, as the opacity. So now when I change that, it'll just go from one to the other. It's like a switch. Then I did mess up here too. You'll notice I plugged the color in. I don't catch that for the top one, the top section. I plugged the color in instead of the delta. So I don't catch that right away, but I'll get it in a second. So now I'm just testing this out probably. I'm adding all the rest of the controls. I forgot to put the E for the UV scale. So now I'm just adding the rest of these controls. So that's the UV layout. That's the one for the switch that switches between them. And let's see. What's the next one I do? I believe rose. Maybe I do rose. Yeah. So the next one I do rows, and I do the rows between 1 and 100 because I want to be able to have them in any way I want. If I want to have one line across the bottom, I want that. If I want to have one line high, I want that. And that gives me the ability to do that as long as I'm less than 100 pages. Then UV scale, or is that spacing? No, that's the scale. I do that between 0 and 1. And the spacing was the last one. And I do that between 0 and 1 as well. I just move that up a little bit. I rearrange these a little. So now I just test these out, spacing, rows, columns, and now here's where I catch my mistake. Well, maybe not yet. So I'm just looking around to see what I might have messed up. I thought it was the aspect at first, but I catch it. So I'm just trying to figure out why nothing's working for the animation part, and it's because I had the color instead of the delta. And that's still not right. I think I grabbed the vector by accident, yeah. So there we go. So that's the completed, that's it completed. That's with all the controls in place. I don't know what I'm doing here. Oh, okay. I'm showing you how... I believe what I do here is show you how that the bones are completely... I probably go through all the controls. Yeah. Turn up the sub-patches. Probably just testing everything out, make sure it works as I want. So you notice with the spread on one, you just get one page turn at a time. Now I have the spread turned up, you get many more. Now the randomness. So I'm just testing it, making sure it looks good. I'm testing the UV layout. Testing the scale, rows, I'm pretty sure that I go over the bones one more time. I remember messing with them, I think. Okay, no, so I go through the node network, that's right. Just to make sure everybody gets what's going on. So, this first top section here, the first section we did, oh, I'm getting all the controls that we have. So I just put all my controls that are output into the sliders over here, just so I have know where they all are and what they're doing. And now this first section here, is the one I'm organizing now. That's what spaces our pages along. The bones on either side of the bones evenly. And it also deals with the binding, and it also deals with scaling them down to it deals with the aspect and scaling them down to zero on the Z to get prepared for moving them with the bones. So that first section is all the deformation that goes on before we move them to the bones. And now what I'm doing is that's the remap. That remaps our object to the bones, object space to the bones. And then this deals with getting the proper bone, and then the bones before and after it, so we can get proper tangents for our rotations. And here's where I catch my mistake from earlier, coming up soon, I think. And now, this bottom section where that gradient is that deals with the turn page turning. And our two controls for the page turning, the spacing and the spread and the turn, and the random, actually. So that's what that does. Now, this part here, that's the rotation matrix, and I'm just subtracting the two, getting the forward, and then using the right from the actual bone that we're on. And here's where I noticed my mistake. You'll see me zoom in. Had I turned the bones anyway, but on the heading, it would have shown itself as a mistake, but I never did on here while I was working on it, so it didn't show up. So, now if anybody has trouble understanding any of this, feel free to leave a comment in comments on the video, and I'll be happy to answer them. But I also have the file in the description. Now this last section here, this is what dealt with the UVs, the 2D array basically, with some controls for spacing and aspect. That's all that is. It's a 2D array with controls for spacing and aspect. And size, but the size is important because we don't change the size. So that's pretty much all there is to that.